Hi, I'm Andy Teach, host of Andy's Awesome Adventures, and welcome to one of the most beautiful cities in the world, Vienna, Austria. This is St. Stephen's Cathedral, more commonly known by its German title, Stephansdom, and it's one of Vienna's most recognizable symbols. It's the mother church of the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Vienna and the seat of the Archbishop of Vienna. It was built on the site of two former churches, the first a parish church consecrated in 1147. In 1258, a great fire destroyed much of the original building, and a larger replacement structure was constructed over the ruins of the old church and consecrated in 1263. An expansion was started in 1304 by King Albert I. His grandson, Duke Rudolf IV, laid the first stone for yet another expansion in 1359, which would bring the church to its current size in Romanesque and Gothic styles. Major reconstruction and expansion lasted until 1511, and repair and restoration projects continue to the present day. During World War II, the cathedral was saved from intentional destruction at the hands of retreating German forces when a German captain disregarded orders from the city commandant to fire 100 shells and leave it in just debris and ashes. However, in 1945, a 22-ton bomb struck the floor of the church, and civilian looters lit fires in nearby shops as Soviet army troops entered the city. The winds carried the fire to the cathedral, where it severely damaged the roof, causing it to collapse, but there was minimal damage to the most valuable artworks. Rebuilding began immediately, with a full reopening in 1952. Built of limestone, the cathedral is 351 feet long, 130 feet wide, and 446 feet tall at its highest point, which is the South Tower, which alone took 65 years to build and was finished in 1433. To this day, it's the highest point in Vienna's inner city skyline. Over the centuries, soot and other forms of air pollution accumulating on the church have given it a black color, but recent restoration projects have again returned some portions of the building to its original white.
They never signed their architects because no handicraft. And only from Renaissance artists onwards, from 1500 onwards, they started signing the architects. But then after the signature already, then they believe now the architect of his name and keep him serving the architects. And now,
aber ist ja zum Beispiel für die Welt der Monika und die Sankt-Wiesen kommt.
Vienna being for a smooth and summertime over the mountains. The chapel is dedicated to St. Catherine, and we'll see her again on the keystone.
The Holy Trinity Column, also known as the Plague Column, is located on the Graben, a pedestrian shopping street in the side of a former 12th century market square. This Baroque memorial is one of the most well-known sculptural pieces in Vienna. It was erected after the Great Plague epidemic in 1679, which some think was the bubonic plague. Fleeing the city, the Habsburg Emperor Leopold I vowed to erect a mercy column if the epidemic would end. A wooden statue was replaced in 1693 by a marble column. The figures at the base represent the triumph of faith over disease, while the mid-portion features the coat of arms and a praying figure of Emperor Leopold I. The gilded sculpture group at the top represents the Holy Trinity seated on a cloud. The monument is also decorated with numerous statues of angels. During the plague, the Brotherhood of the Holy Trinity created special plague hospitals to care for the infected and deal with the dead bodies, most of which were burned outside the city limits in giant plague pits. This was an improvement on the previous just leave them there and don't touch them approach. Hofburg Palace is a former imperial palace. Today, part of the palace forms the official residence and workplace of the President of Austria. Built in the 13th century and expanded in the century since, the palace has housed some of the most powerful people in European and Austrian history, including monarchs of the Hapsburg Dynasty, rulers of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. It was their principal imperial winter residence, as Schonbrunn Palace was their summer residence. Construction of the complex we know today started after 1533, when Ferdinand I decided to move his main residence to Vienna, making it the capital of the Holy Roman Empire. Today, the Hofburg Palace is a tourist magnet, and visitors flock to see the royal apartments, chapel, church, library, and the many museums that are housed in the complex, which consists of 18 wings with more than 2,000 rooms, designed in a wide range of architectural styles. We're in the Crown Jewels Museum or the Treasury, and I finally found the family jewels. It's good to be the king.
Thank you.
It's a reproduction. But it still looks good. This is 17th century, made out of amber. This is embroidery on linen, metal and silk threads, pearls, glass and velvet. This is the imperial crown. Beautiful. This is the saber of Charlemagne, over 1,000 years old. In 1913, the southwest wing of the palace, known as the New Castle in Neuburg, was completed. Today it houses a number of museums. The Heldenplatz, or Hero Square, is a public plaza in front of the Hofburg Palace. There were two equestrian statues featuring two Austrian war heroes. This one is of Archduke Charles of Austria, who defeated Napoleon in 1809. The outer castle gate remained standing when Vienna's fortification walls were dismantled in the 1860s. Erected in 1824, it was inaugurated by Emperor Francis I to commemorate the Battle of Leipzig in 1813, where Austria and its allies defeated the outnumbered troops of Napoleon. It was rebuilt as a war memorial in 1933 and 1934. Many people aren't aware of this, but Adolf Hitler was born in Austria, not Germany. Hitler's ceremonial announcement from the balcony of the Neuburg of the Austrian Anschluss, the annexation of Austria into the Third Reich of Nazi Germany, occurred here on March 15, 1938. He was warmly welcomed by the Austrians. The campaign against Jews began the day after the Anschluss. Of the more than 65,000 Viennese Jews who were deported to concentration camps, little more than 2,000 survived. Schonbrunn Palace is a former imperial summer residence which has been open to tourists since the 1950s, and it's Vienna's number one tourist destination. The 1,441-room Baroque Palace is one of the most important architectural, cultural, and historical monuments in the country. Hundreds of years ago, this area was used for hunting and recreation. The name Schonbrunn, meaning beautiful spring, has its roots in an artesian well from which water was consumed by the court. The Schonbrunn Palace in its present form was built and remodeled in the 1740s to 1750s during the reign of Empress Maria Theresa, who received the estate as a wedding gift. Napoleon had his headquarters here in the early 1800s. Franz Joseph, the longest reigning emperor of Austria, was born in Schonbrunn and spent a great deal of his life here. Following the downfall of the Habsburg monarchy in 1918, the palace became the property of the newly founded Austrian Republic and was preserved as a museum. After World War II, and during the Allied occupation of Austria, Schonbrunn Palace was used to provide offices for the British. With the reestablishment of the Austrian Republic in 1955, the palace once again became a museum. It is still sometimes used for important events, such as the meeting between U.S. President John F. Kennedy and Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev in 1961. The garden points toward a 200-foot-high hill, which since 1775 has been crowned by the Gloriette structure. It was used as a dining hall and festival hall, as well as a breakfast room for Emperor Franz Joseph I. Maria Theresa decided Gloriette should be designed to glorify Habsburg power. The Gloriette was destroyed in the Second World War, but had been restored by 1947 and was restored again in
left-hand side coming up now, Musikverein, that's the name of our major concert hall, where the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra plays all the symphony concerts. And it is here where they play every 1st of January, beginning of the new year, quite a famous concert, international concert, the Vienna New Year's Concert, played by the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra. This year we had more than 140 countries connected with Vienna. So it was transmitted throughout the world. The monument to the Russian soldier, and this monument was built by the Russians during that 10-year lasting occupation. And the Russians claimed a clause into the treaty saying that we have to maintain forever that monument. If not, Russians were allowed to occupy Austria again by the Red Army. On the left is the city park, huge garden. Here's the direction of the public gardeners. You see, Vienna is a very green city. More than half of the city is covered with green. It means approximately 53%. And here on our left-hand side is a brick building housing the Museum of Applied Arts or Decorative Arts. Very nice collections in here. Old porcelain collection, then an Art Nouveau collection, and especially old carpets. On the right, you see the monument to Neue holding his hand on his heart, but actually Viennese people say it's not his heart that he's holding, but his wallet. You might remember from TV, because it was transmitted throughout the world, all the negotiations with Iran against atomic energy, if you remember. There was the monument. You see it on a lot of picture cards. Johann Strauss' son was the most important member of the Strauss dynasty. They all composed typically Viennese music, such as waltzes, polkas, operettas, marches, and so on. So Vienna has a long, long, very important tradition of music. And so the best you could do here in Vienna is to join a concert. Johann Strauss' son had a nickname which was the King of the Waltzes. It was a brand new music in 1800, and people loved to sing and to dance the waltzes. He was a very handsome man, had black hair, black locks, and his female fans, they all wanted to get a lock of their idol. And so do you know what his manager did? He just cut black curls of goats and sent them to the fence. So everybody was happy. On the left you see the Imperial Hotel, which is the number one hotel in Vienna, where all the state guests are accommodated during their stay. It's a beautiful, old-fashioned hotel. So next time when you come to Vienna, make yourself invited as a state guest, and then you will be given the Imperial Suite that covers the whole first floor. If not, you can also book for a few thousand dollars a night, depends on the season.
In the background you see St. Stephen's again. And here on the right is the main facade of the opera house that survived to see the black flag for mourning, because a very popular singer died quite young the day after yesterday. So we are all very sad.
Vienna University, it was founded in 1365. So last year we had a big jubilee, 650 years of our university. And this was actually the second German-speaking university. First German university was in Prague. Now there is a big bus, but I hope you can see the beautiful church behind on the left, which is Votive Church. It's a neo-Gothic church. And you see on top of the spires, crowns instead of crosses. It's a very busy day for ambulance. On the right you see Vienna's Stock Exchange. Some years ago we had a terrible fire in here. The beautiful ceiling fresco was completely destroyed. There was a certain period in which we had every Friday 13th, considered to be an unlucky day, a big fire on some of the public buildings.
You can't see from here the house facade because it's all covered with green.
Yeah.
And all those trees are planted inside. This is the Hundertwassehaus here on the left. Look, the trees are planted inside, and outside you see the branches of the trees, and on top this is all a wood, let's say. And a very fancy facade, different colors, differently styled columns, put in different ways. Something really very strange. And every window is different from the other. Yeah, it looks like Gaudi in Barcelona. Yeah, very much. As a matter of fact, he was influenced by Gaudi, and he was influenced also by Art Nouveau.
Rathaus is the city hall of Vienna. Built from 1872 to 1883 in a neo-Gothic style, according to plans designed by cathedral master builder Friedrich von Schmidt, it houses the office of the mayor of Vienna as well as the chambers of the city council. It features five towers, including the central tower with a height of 322 feet. In 1882, the Rathausman statue of an armored knight holding a lance was installed on the top, which soon became one of the symbols of Vienna. This is the People's Guard, and I'm a people. The Austrian Parliament Building is where the two houses of the Austrian Parliament conduct their sessions. The building was completed in 1883 with Austrian marble. The architect responsible for its Greek Revival style aimed to have each element harmonize with all the others. Following heavy damage and destruction in World War II, most of the interior has been restored. The building contains over 100 rooms and is the site of important state ceremonies, most notably the swearing-in ceremony of the President of Austria.
Thank you.
Bronze statues of horse tamers are located at the two lower ends of the ramp. They are a symbol of the suppression of passion, an important precondition for successful parliamentary cooperation. Further bronze works are the chariots on top of the roof, each chariot pulled by four horses and steered by the goddess Nike. The bronze works had to undergo extensive restoration work in the 1990s due to damage from acid rain and air pollution. Further oxidation corroded the bronze over the decades and ate holes into the sculptures. The Athena Fountain was erected between 1893 and 1902. The female statues above represent the legislative and executive powers of the state. Athena is dressed in armor with a gilded helmet. Her left hand carries a spear, her right carries Nike. Maria Theresa Square is a large public square that joins the Ringstrasse, or Ring Road, with the Museum Quarter. Facing each other from the sides of the square are two near-identical buildings, the Natural History Museum and the Art History Museum, which is located on the grounds of the former Imperial Stables. The two museums and the square joining them were built in 1889. The 62-foot-high, 44-ton bronze statue of the popular Empress Maria Theresa in the square's center took 13 years to complete. She greets the people with her right hand, and in the left hand she holds a scepter and a document roll which is related to the succession of the Hapsburg dynasty. She is surrounded by her closest advisors, including four generals.
Looks like we're shooting a movie, but we're far from Hollywood. This is Vienna. This is the view from our hotel in Vienna of the Danube River. And so ends the tour of our view of the Danube River. Well, one thing I get very paranoid about is taking mass transportation in a foreign city. I can barely get by a New York subway, and I used to work there. So here we are in Vienna. You get here and the station, the train station, it's in German, but the good news is they have English, so that should make it easy. So we're gonna put our money in and see what happens. All right, we got our tickets and we're gonna go up the stairs. Doesn't seem to be a lot of people here, but we are going to the city center of Vienna, where we were earlier today. It's overwhelming how much great architecture there was. It's all kind of a blur. So we're gonna go back in the evening and take a closer look. Here's the map. I think we have like 11 stops before we get there. But it's only 220 euros as opposed to like a $20 or $30 cab fare. So it's worth it. All aboard. Oh, very nice.
Lokalbahn nach Baden. Wir sind am Ziel. Bitte steigen Sie aus. Auf Wiedersehen.
Auf Wiedersehen.
Last stop. Please leave the train. gefallen. Ausstieg rechts.
We're approaching Karlsplatz, the final stop. Time to go.
The Vienna State Opera took 8 years to build and was completed in 1869, following plans drawn up by two architects, neither of whom lived to see the completion of the building. One committed suicide and one died of tuberculosis. Towards the end of World War II, the opera was set afire by an American bombardment. One section survived, but the stage and auditorium, as well as 150,000 costumes, were destroyed by flames. It wasn't until 1955 that the opera house was reopened. Well, when in Vienna, you need to take a horse and buggy ride, or a cab. We're taking a 20-minute ride, a short ride through the city. We're by the Hofburg Palace. Let's see if this is a guided tour. There we go, nice and smooth now. We're going a little slower than our bus today. Hello, children. Hello. Bye. I know, they don't know. And this may look familiar. We were here yesterday. Beautiful square. Now, if this guy has a heart attack, I'm gonna have to take over the reins. Yeah.
the end.